My name is Kim Polese. I am co-founder and chairman of a company called CrowdSmart, and we are building a new form of human-empowered AI to help groups make better decisions, more accurate predictions, solve problems together, co-create solutions with less bias and greater accuracy. And I'd like to give you a little background on the company, just why we founded this company. My co-founder and I, Tom Kaler, both founded companies that we took public, and we were able to found these companies because we had relationships. We knew people in the venture capital world. But many, many entrepreneurs, many great founders with talent don't have those relationships, don't know people in the venture capital world. And unfortunately, as we know, talent is very evenly distributed, but opportunity and access to capital, unfortunately, is not. And we decided to found CrowdSmart to create a new form of AI and decision making that would help increase access to capital in the particular specific case of raising money as a startup. And so we built a core technology. This technology is based on the combination of human collective intelligence and predictive analytics. And we actually decided to raise a small venture fund and test the predictive accuracy of this approach to large-scale, collective intelligence-driven decision-making, a combination, again, of human and machine intelligence. The idea really is co-creating. The idea, the ability to, for groups of people to collectively ideate, make decisions, and be able to track the outcomes to ensure increased accuracy. We raised this small fund and invested in about 30 companies out of about 150. We built a community of several thousand people, and about 35 to 45 people per company would do the evaluation. And ultimately, we measured the outcome and determined that this approach was over 80% accurate at predicting which companies would go from seed to Series A, or a significant increase in valuation, attract follow-on funding. That's about four times better than the average venture capital firm. We also determined that this approach reduced bias significantly, and it turned out that over 40% of the high-scoring companies were women-founded or women-led. Almost 50% were underrepresented founders, founded by people who are underrepresented. And so we realized we had a very powerful technology here, one that was much better at predicting outcomes than your typical venture capital firm, and also one that reduced bias and increased access to capital. And we had a choice. Should we just become a big venture capital firm, raise a big fund, and invest using this new form of AI, or should we make this technology available for everyone? And we decided to do the latter. We decided to, in fact, spin off the fund, productize this core technology, and make it available for anyone to use for any decision, for any solution that they are trying to create. And essentially, this is a decision, this is an operating system, almost a decision operating system for any kind of solution, co-creation, problem solving, decision making. And we realized it's very powerful. In fact, it has application for many different kinds of industries. This is, again, the outcome of the decentralized investment network that we created. Because of these results, we decided to focus on expanding the applications, the use cases, to several different areas. And let me give you a vision of how companies are able to use this new kind of decision operating system. One is new product development. And Larry touched on this, the brand co-creation, the ability for customers to co-create products with companies. The ability for a customer to actually determine what the next features of a product is, for the passionate customers to engage together with the companies that they buy products from. Organizational transformation, for example, a digital transformation project where a company is spending billions of dollars, they have thousands of employees who know what will work and what won't work, but often those employees are left out of the decision making. So an organizational transformation project has a much better chance of succeeding if you engage everybody in the ideation, in the ultimate decision making about what will work and what won't. And finally, participatory democracy, the ability for citizens to engage in their community, to decide on what kind of environment they want, what kind of engagement they want to have with their cities, what kind of solutions they want to have to the problems that they face in daily life. So this technology, again, is applicable to a wide range of problems and abilities to co-create solutions. It scales to ultimately any number, any size of group, so there is no limit to scalability, and it, again, is based on this new form of AI. So let me talk a little more about how it actually works. This is an example of a decision, in this case, a decision about whether to build a new product or to buy a product inside of a company. Oftentimes, you face this build or buy decision. And you might have a team, a large team inside of your company that's helping you decide, should we build internally or should we buy from outside? So the way it starts is everybody gets to review the background materials, all of the insight and data and knowledge that exists about this decision. And then there's a series of open-ended questions. Should we build or buy? Specific drill-down questions, detailed questions about all of the elements of the pros and cons. Each person then creates their answers, writes a few sentences. Again, open-ended questions, open-ended answers. They also rate each other's proposals. They see other people's ideas. It's all anonymized, so the ideas are separated from the identities. The AI is in the background acting like a super facilitator, essentially listening to everybody synchronously all at once, identifying points of alignment, and also constantly seeking outlier ideas. And this is happening very rapidly. So this is all in real time. It's able to, the AI essentially is a very good listener, is able to ultimately identify the collective knowledge and insight and wisdom of the entire group and deliver a result, a decision, an outcome, a solution. In this case, the build or the buy. And ultimately, it also develops a computational decision model, a program that you can then query, ask questions of, do what-if analysis, look at different ways of examining the problem. What if we only listened to people in product development? What would they say about this decision? And this persistent decision model is something that essentially grows and adds knowledge over time each time people interact with the system. So it essentially is a model of the collective mind. So there's some deep AI behind this, and let me very quickly go through what that is. The first is something called Markov models. I mentioned that participants are presented with lists of each other's ideas that they can then rank. Markov models essentially find the points of resonance in a conversation and learn the priorities from very large group interactions. Natural language processing is also part of this, and what you're seeing here in the video is a live decision model. You can see that as the mouse hovers over different points, you see people's ideas, reasons, thoughts about the decision at hand. So this is actually creating a geometry of all of the ideas that are going into forming this decision. And it also identifies the why behind why people believe something. And that's very important. Bayesian belief networks are an incredibly important part of this new form of AI. What they do is create a probability score. When there's a lot of uncertainty in complex environments, you need a system that allows the ability to identify what's the most likely outcome. And in the case of Bayesian belief networks and probabilistic graphical models, this builds essentially a cognitive model of all of the ideas, all of the thinking that goes into a decision. And then finally, unsupervised learning of conversations. This is essentially an output that makes very clear what the key themes are that result. Like, for example, if it's a question about an investment, you know, very strong product team, but they have a weak go-to-market plan. This is actually a report of a specific investment decision. The unsupervised learning essentially makes sense and creates patterns out of very complex language and creates a narrative out of the entire group's thinking. So if you're familiar with GPT-3, which makes sense out of massive amounts of text, what this is doing is essentially generating an output that summarizes the entire collective knowledge and insights of groups of all sizes. And ultimately, what you are delivering is a collective mind, a model of the collective mind that is based on this combination of human and machine intelligence. It reduces bias because, again, this is all anonymized. All of the ideation is anonymized. DAOs can be integrated with this approach, and we'll talk about that in a minute. The AI super facilitator is constantly finding where people are aligning and also making sure that fresh ideas are heard. All of the ideas are synthesized into the knowledge model that is developed. And ultimately, the themes, influences behind the themes, and the decision is the outcome. And again, it's a queryable model, so you can always go back and find every single reason that every person entered and trace that. So how this might benefit Web3 and DAOs. Today, in a DAO environment, it's very transaction-based. You've got tokens. You are able to transact with your tokens. But there's no ability to really converse, to ideate, to debate, and deliberate. And in this approach with human-empowered AI, you can actually integrate ideation into DAOs. Instead of having to go off to Discourse or Discord or Snapshot or all these different tools that right now people are using when they're trying to come up with a voting mechanism. You can move from discussion to actual decision-making, where there's a definitive outcome, and you also have all of the reasons and the collective reasoning that went into that outcome. You move from the individual, where you're basically focused on my wallet, my tokens, what is my address, to the group and this co-creation of a collective knowledge model of everyone who is deliberating about the decision that they're making. And move from a traditional voting mechanism, which is basically very up or down, and Larry calls it dumb voting, which is very apt, to co-designed voting mechanisms, where the group can actually decide what kind of voting mechanism do they want. In the case of an investment decision, in the case of CrowdSmart, in our first iteration, we decided that anything that scored over 74%, the company would invest in. You might have a very high impact vote where you want to make sure that you have a high threshold for the vote passing. But the entire community can decide how that vote should be structured. And then moving from an opaque rationale where you don't know why a decision was made, you don't know why what people thought when they voted yes or no, to a persistent context. In other words, the ability to go back into the decision model and identify exactly what people said, why they said it, without the identities, but what were the key ideas that really resonated. A very quick example is the city of Cincinnati. So we're actually working with the city of Cincinnati, embarking on a project with the community. And the community wants to co-create solutions to challenges. They want to decide on new ideas for economic opportunity. They want to develop new strategies to reduce crime. They want to create a vibrant economic opportunity in Cincinnati, and they want to be part of coming up with ideas. They want their voices to be heard. And so this is about, in fact, getting thousands of people, many thousands of people, involved in a conversation where they're simultaneously giving their ideas and where the AI is listening, finding what are the best ideas that are rising to the top based on what everyone else thinks of each other's ideas, and then coming out with a prioritized list. And then phase two is really going off to enact the decisions that collective community made in a process that, again, is guided by the AI. The AI is not deciding for the people. The AI is listening to what the people are thinking and refining it and identifying exactly what the best ideas are as voted by the collective. So it's a very powerful way of ensuring that you're getting all the ideas in the picture and that it is equitable, that you are de-biasing the whole environment. And the way that this would work in a DAO environment, you basically kick off, create the DAO, and then off-chain, you can create your proposal, provide all supporting materials around whatever decision you're trying to make. The group ideates, and this could happen over a couple of hours, could happen over days or weeks, however long the group wants to debate. And then a decision point is arrived at. Recommendations are surfaced. There's a proposal that is output, there's a voting mechanism that the community has decided on. And then ultimately, that vote in the proposal is written as a contract to the blockchain. The vote is made and the action is taken. You can go back in at any point and re-engage and continue ideating if the community wants to do that. So this is a way to ensure that you're integrating decision-making and deliberation and collective ideation into a DAO environment instead of having that sort of decision process happen, you know, somewhere else and ultimately not enabling a collective mind or collective knowledge model. And finally, what should the design look like? The protocol design, this is a vision, should be transparent, it should be debiased, it should be open and accessible. Governance, the ideas of a proof of thought and proof of creativity, proof of impact, go beyond just proof of work. So proof of thought might be inside of a company. An employee has a great idea for this digital transformation project. That idea gets momentum, and that employee ultimately is recognized for the idea they had and rewarded, gets recognition or attribution. Proof of creativity might be a company co-creating or co-designing products with their customers. They have a new feature that they think a shoe design would benefit from. They are ultimately able to benefit from being identified as putting forth creative ideas that have impact. And proof of impact might be a community co-creating, again, solutions on the ground in their own environment, and these ideas then are implemented, and the question is, did they have the impact desired? So you can measure that and then, again, attribute value back to the people who were participating in creating those ideas. Open design is really critical, so you want to create open protocols, open license, open source, and ensure that the whole process of making decisions is transparent for everyone who's participating. So this is, again, a vision. Let me just end by observing that Japan really has an important heritage in the design of the future of Web3, because very, very significantly, this technology, this human-empowered AI, is based on something called neural nets. And neural nets are a pillar of deep learning. Kunihiko Fukushima was a preeminent developer, an engineer in the 70s who created one of the earliest forms of deep neural nets. And that inspired, in turn, deep learning, which is behind the natural language processing, the ability to create these large language models that enable the listening to conversations, massive numbers of conversations at scale. And so when we think about integrating this approach of collective intelligence, natural language processing, Bayesian belief networks, the probabilistic computing I mentioned, with DAOs, we can actually envision a future of co-creating solutions at scale and enabling us to tap into what makes us human, our ability to collectively solve problems, and enable everyone to participate in that environment in a way that's equitable, and in a way that can actually affect democracy. There is a potential for change here that's very positive, and a new form of AI is required to do that. And again, thank you, Joey, for inviting me here to speak about it.
Thanks, Kim, and I think that follows really well with from where Larry was leading us, so thank you. And we're gonna go on and hear from the others before the conversation. So Ariel, you wanna share your thoughts?
Well, first of all, thank you so much to DG for hosting and having us today. And I currently work in the field of space exploration, but I started my work in a terrestrial environment. Can you guys go ahead and go to the first slide? I think those are the last ones. There we go. So I now work in space exploration, but I began my graduate studies at the MIT Media Lab under Joey, working on distributed systems and blockchain technology. And my master's thesis looked at an attempt to do what Professor Lessig had inspired us to do, which is, can we use blockchain and Web3 and a DAO-like system for big problems that are facing society? The goal with MedRec was to put pointers to your medical information that might live in many different content repositories, your pediatrician's, you know, office for your kid, your cardiologist, your primary care physician. They all have different silos that contain your information, your medical data. we would not want to pool the raw data itself all into one location. That would be a massive target for hacking. But could we use a blockchain-like system of smart contracts to essentially establish a table of contents, a log of where you could go to access all of your information all at once? And this birthed MedRec, which we ultimately deployed successfully at one of the most innovative hospitals in Boston, Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center, BIDMC. Has over 2,000 citations as the implementation paper has been spun out and used in many different contexts. So began with an interest in distributed systems. Folks, I think it's jumping to the end. Is there a way to just go straight through? I have the memory, or switch the thing. Oh, I see, there we go, thank you. So now in the context of space exploration, my goal for today is to show you some of the really novel areas in this field where we might also be able to apply tools like Web3, DAOs, and blockchains. My group at MIT, we focus on designing, prototyping, and building these artifacts of our sci-fi space future. I'll spend just briefly time today going over how close we are to this future. And what I'd like to call out is that this domain is no longer solely the area of military, defense, and government. There's a great opportunity for crowdsourced systems, for communities like DAOs to begin implementing new ideas of governance in the space ecosystem. This is an example of the team behind the Space Initiative. It's a large and diverse team, many different backgrounds. Another point here is the need for an interdisciplinary approach to a highly technical environment, so bringing in more than just scientists and engineers. To give you a sense of the types of technologies that will be part of this future and could be benefited by collective design, here are two slides that give you the breadth of the types of things that we're working on. I'll just briefly call out the corner that says space architecture. This is my PhD work, since finished 2 years ago, and the notion was to take a decentralized, open source approach to building infrastructure for life in space. The question being, how do we scale humanity's presence in orbit? We need to be able to build infrastructure that can house many more people than the International Space Station or Tiangong, the structures that are currently available in space. And one approach is to take inspiration from the open source community, the decentralized community, and say, let's build structures that are themselves modular, reconfigurable, and can be remixed with control by the people who live in them. And this is where some of the agency of the individual can come in a structure like a DAO, where you have designed in a smart contract type system your own principles of operating your habitat. The habitat itself is a responsive engineering system. There are many ways that we can imagine, almost like IoT in a smart home, but instead of that being, a closed Apple or Microsoft or Google system, there's a great potential, I think, for community governance, open access, and a more optimistic vision of the agency that we'll have for life in space. We really are building and at the cusp of this future. This is an example of a zero gravity parabolic flight. We bring projects that are engineering hardware on these flights every year. This image is really just to show you that this future is here. We are already building these artifacts. And in particular, I wanted to call out an amazing project where we will be sending a swarm robot, another example of decentralized hardware, to the surface of the moon next summer, thanks to Digital Garage. This is a project that is sponsored by DG, going to be sending that small swarm robot that you see on the top of the rover to the surface of the moon next summer. It is really remarkable, if you pause to think, about this level of access, that inside of a 2-year period, we can go from contracting, fully developing, and implementing hardware on the surface of a celestial body like this. And again, I want to call out this scene because on the surface of the moon, we don't yet have any real firm governance structures. We do have principles from things like the 1967 Outer Space Treaty, and we have goals and ambitions and aspirations in the Moon Treaty, but as Professor Lessig and others know, the US is not necessarily always party to all of these treaties, certainly not the Moon Treaty. And in this case, in the moon, we will have corporate actors, multi-stakeholder corporate actors, going to the moon first, even before nation states are going with their own national space programs. And so this raises a really interesting opportunity for a blank slate for how to govern interactions on the moon. Everything from border rights, property rights, water rights, landing pads, and how do you protect your landing pad and get back to Earth, all kinds of really interesting considerations that are a worthy opportunity to begin thinking about the application of DAOs. and collective governance. And if that was the artist's render, this is the real version that's actually gonna get sent next spring into the summer. If you're interested in learning more about this ecosystem and the types of work that has been produced over the last few years, I just wanted to point you to a book that we recently released with MIT Press. And on a final note, I'll close by giving kind of an early heads up about a new startup ecosystem that I've just begun to try to realize many of these different projects. So if you are out there in the audience and you're interested in collaborating and maybe bringing your Web3 expertise to the space environment, please reach out. I'd love to work with you and think about how do we co-design an optimistic and open access future for light and space. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Ariel. じゃあ次は原さんお願いします。
あ、あ、Thank you. Let me introduce myself in English. I am Mayumi from Dev Protocol. Dev Protocol is an open source decentralized middleware designed for creators to sustainably challenge their projects. And we are based in Japan and Switzerland. And I myself started my entrepreneurship career in the Web2 field 10 years ago. And I supported brands and companies for their marketing around various industries in Japan. And one day, I was asked by a traditional artisan company, this is a photo, their work is very unique. They work for temples, Japanese temples, and they make everything for temples, including architecture and jewelry goods inside temples. Those are including national treasures. And I think their work is very special, but they were very economically undervalued. Like the number is, their revenue is only tenths of an online gaming company. And they have a problem to hire younger people to grow their successors of their traditional craftsmanship. But the number is very serious, I think. And that means if you want to be rich or make earnings, you shouldn't be artisans, as the number says. So I think this is not the marketing problem of this company, but a market problem itself. So I started Dev Protocol to fix the market problem in 2018. Sorry, next slide. And what Dev Protocol do is, very simply speaking, bring Web2 creator economy to Web3 creator economy. For example, if you have a GitHub account or a Discord server, you can tokenize your account with the proof of ownership and start Web3 monetization within just few clicks. And now we are building, that was a bit technical explanation, and what we are now building is no-code tool for everyone can jump in Web3 world and start DAOs within 1 minute. It's the Clubs. And Clubs is very simple to use, like WordPress for DAOs. So you can use Clubs and choose design template and choose governance template and freely add plugins. And there is a marketplace you can connect with. You can connect with lawyers and mentors, on Clubs. And Clubs is not officially published, officially released yet, but we offer Clubs to strategic partners. And this is the first case, Temple's DAO. You may remember that I explained the traditional artisan company. They came Web3 first. And this DAO is a bit unique, and their mission is to support restoration of Japanese temples and support growing artisans in Japan. And there are some unique perks for DAO members. There is examples, and you can if you join that temple's DAO, and you can get an invitation of a special room of the temple, or temple's event, and there is a super tier with the right of order-made products to the artisan. That artisan is a real temple artisans. So if so you may build you may order made like Buddha statue in your office if you are interested. And the artisan company is the artisan company is very new to Web3 world. Because their work is to deal with real temples, over 17,000 temples in Japan, and they have a plan to make all DAOs of those Japanese temples, so that they have a plan to temples DAO holdings, and they are now learning about DAOs with their small DAO members, and they are trying to new things little by little. So here are some examples, and they are starting NFT projects for restoration of Japanese temples and the quests to increase their contributors. So they are starting, they are just started Web3 world, and their NFT as a card template style, so that they want everyone can participate in their project. So Japanese temples and monks and all local communities can start selling their NFTs for their projects. So we think those communities can be now more united through DAOs today. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, so lastly, Tim, do you want to go?
Okay, cool. Hello, everyone. Thank you for having me. I'm here from an organization, a DAO, actually, a service DAO called Macro. And as you can see, we do smart contract security audits. And that points up the fact that, as Larry had mentioned, the beginning of DAOs was marred by an immediate scandal or a giant hack of $60 million worth of the treasury that was assembled. And since then, there have been many, many hacks. The nature of code and data on the blockchain by design, if it's a public blockchain, which the, you know, we think the more interesting ones are public blockchains, it's entirely exposed for scrutiny, for examination by anyone, including the so-called black hats or people with bad intentions, and they'll look for vulnerabilities in your contract code, and they'll also look for exploitable patterns in the data itself. So all of the events that happen on the blockchain are a giant log of everything that's happened, and it exposes all the patterns of behavior that can be used against you. And so there are lots of hackers in the bad sense out there who try to exploit your code. And so we all have, the members of this macro organization, so we all have a long history of building things ourselves. We're founders and you know, serial entrepreneurs and things like that. And we thought about launching our own stuff directly in Web3, but we thought we would pause first and try to help the overall ecosystem by, you know, our tagline is to help Web3 builders build. And we thought that the place that we could stand with the most leverage to help other builders build was to help them with smart contract security on the one hand, and also, let's see, which direction is this? Ah, good. So we do security audits of other people's contracts, and then we also run an engineering fellowship, which, as it says there, is for senior engineers who want to learn more security and other best practices in writing smart contracts. And I ran out of room to put even more logos onto this slide, but when we say senior engineers, we're actually talking about people from Google or from Uber or Meta or so-called FANG adjacent companies, those kinds of sort of famous Web2 places. The senior engineers there are often very curious and motivated by the promise and prospects of Web3 that have been outlined so ably by the other members of this panel. It's very exciting to us engineers. And so one of the things, the other thing that we wanted to do is not just help other existing Web3 organizations with their contracts, but to bring more people into the ecosystem. And so we decided to create this fellowship, and we bring in very senior folks, like the first engineer at Uber Freight, or the first engineer of this or that secret operating system projects at places that won't be named, and so on and so forth. So very interesting background type of engineers who can do a lot of, they can build. And then we train them in security and optimization and the patterns for architecting solutions in Web3. And so we think that that human element is really important. And in fact, the theme of the human element around these, as Larry says, poorly named smart contracts, they're actually rather dumb, that human element is extremely important. And in as many ways as possible, we want to help all the super nerds of the world, such as the people on this panel, at least as far as code and system building goes, to take strong Web2 capabilities and then move them into the Web3 space. So that's why we're here.
Thank you, Tim.
All right.
And I want to tie it back to kind of where Larry ended up, and kind of at the beginning, just thinking about, you know, architecture. And maybe, Larry, I don't know if you have some thoughts, but because it feels like we're sort of going up the layers of the stack It was kind of like you called Vitalik a full stack philosopher, but I think this blockchain layer is a higher layer in the stack, and we've been doing architecture in the TCP/IP and the web layers, and you know, poorly mostly. I think we've tried to keep it open, but we ended up with platforms. I thought that Wi-Fi would make all wireless free, and we have cell phones and no independent ISPs anymore. So we always think we're going open, and then it goes closed. And I remember the early days of blogging. Hayasan showed Ev. Well, Ev, before Twitter, created Blogger. And on Blogger, you could download all of your posts and move them to a different blog. All of the blogs in the early days were open. It was decentralized, and you ran them on your own server, Blogger being one of the earlier centralized ones. So I feel like I've been betrayed. Every layer of the stack, we thought it would be open. We thought we could lock the internet open with technology. Then it just collapses into this closed thing. And where I think a lot of the people who don't remember the early days think, oh, well, with Web3, it's inherently decentralized, you know, but I think that's dumb, right? Dumb contracts. And I'm thinking just as a first, I guess this half, we all remember before there was internet. I mean, what do you think? Do you think this layer, maybe to the both, because you did Java, which was also a really interesting architectural experiment. I mean, what do you think we need to do, and how likely is it that a lot of the young people's dreams about DAOs is actually not going to happen?
Well, I would diagnose the concentration as a function of business models of the internet. Like when the internet was, you know, when we first connected to the internet, advertising was not the central way of thinking about what the internet would be. But when Google figured out it had a business model, and that was advertising, and then Facebook thought it had an even better business model for advertising, and it built these infrastructures of data gathering so that their AIs could better drive engagement, that had a natural tendency to concentration and the power of the biggest players. And I don't think we can in any way guarantee that Web3 won't trip on a similar kind of concentrating business model. Who knows? But I think that there's lots of reasons to think that the types of infrastructures we're talking about are much more diverse, and the capacity they are facilitating is much more diverse. And so all we can do is to build with the objective of facilitating a much wider range of engagement. One of the projects I didn't get to talk about, but I found incredibly interesting, is the work describing antitrust and the blockchain, and the way antitrust law needs to evolve to be able to evaluate the blockchain. But if it did, it could be much more effective in keeping these structures decentralized than it has been in the context of Web 2. So that's to say, there's no guarantee. We don't yet see what the business model will be. We just know what we need to be protecting ourselves against, because I think you're right. I think we all should feel betrayed by the way the net evolved so far.
Yeah, I think that's right. One of the things that actually is new and different is the ability, these large language models, the ability to actually listen to conversations at scale that did not exist back then. At the very beginning, and really only in the last 5, 6, 7 years have we had now the capability, the capacity to have every voice heard, understood, listened to at scale, and make sense of that, actually turn natural language into decisions, into predictions, into an outcome. So it's a new technological breakthrough that actually has the potential to empower the individual.
And I do think, though, to Larry's point, it's what's the business model behind it, right? Because I remember when we were doing the early social media, we said, if we could just give everyone a voice, democracy would be solved.
Right.
But then you created an amplification of shouting rather than listening.
That's right.
And I feel like for traditional AI, it costs a lot of money to run, and it costs a lot of money to build. So the people who have it are the people with money, so governments and platforms. And they use AI to predict what poor people do or individuals do. And prediction basically takes power from the predict E, the person being predicted, to gives it to the predictor, right? And so using AI for prediction and for amplification of engagement, which is what Larry is talking about, I think doesn't go to understanding, which was my, I think the fallacy of the give everyone a voice argument.
Right.
So then the question sort of is, what is the business model for your product? What is the business? And I think this gets to some of what Mayumi's talking about with, you know, her Temple DAO, because the business model is what the people want, right? And if the cost is, and I think the other piece is cost, so probabilistic computing doesn't cost as much as deep learning. And
right.
so, and large language models will be a commodity, everyone will make it and compete, that's fine that it costs a lot of money. But I think what's interesting about DAOs, and gets back to Larry and my point about it being very low cost, is that there isn't a lot, if there isn't a lot of cost, and the communities creating the DAOs, the business model is really the thing they're trying to do, which is preserve temples or something like that, that maybe then they can use the tools that will amplify the pro-social behavior rather than the commercial extraction. I guess I'm being a little bit complicated, but I feel like making it lower cost makes the customer a different thing than what we have right now, which is, you know, only those that have a lot of resources. But I don't know if you agree with this at all. And
I think it's important to recognize the system already has high costs. Mm-hmm. The law is a high cost inside the system. Mm-hmm. Systems of governance in real space are high cost systems. And to the extent we're talking about building infrastructures of technology in a Web3-like way, a DAO-like way, that could be lowering the cost of the law and the governance. And so it's shifting potentially down the total cost of the infrastructure. And if it does that, I think it creates a wider opportunity for many more people to participate in these structures of governance.
But there's a resistance to lowering costs, right? Because
yeah.
somebody's cost is somebody's revenue.
Right.
And I guess maybe around the space, or you want to jump in, Tim, go.
I just wanted to ask what might be a bit of a naive question, but you're talking, Larry, about the cost of governance and so forth, and then you're talking about lowering the cost of, but of what? Governance over what? Is it, and you were also talking about business models, but then what's the intersection with the temples and so on and so forth, social good type of stuff? Are we talking about the cost, lowering the cost of transactions?
My view would be that getting a lawyer, setting up a bank account, having a board, creating an organization to help temples costs so much money mm-hmm. that you have to raise money, you have to have philanthropists, and then there's the chairman of the board. Whereas if you can go to Dev Protocol and click and set up a thing, you don't, because it's low cost, you don't have to introduce all of these other stakeholders that you have to introduce if there's a cost, right? So it makes also accessible structured organizations and maybe even tools like what Kim is working on to organizations that otherwise could not afford to have an org, right?
An organizational
right.
structure.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, to put it in terms of computer technology, and this is something, I'm gonna say something that no lawyer will agree with, but it's true. We are going to commodify legal services. We're going to radically lower the cost of legal services because it'll be this click and you bring legal infrastructure into a space. And that will mean organizations right now that couldn't imagine constructing a legal infrastructure or a governance infrastructure for themselves just because it's so expensive will be able to do it. And so there'll be new organizations that can form and do work, like I think the Temple DAO is a great example of that, because we've commodified this really inefficient part of our society, governance and the law.
Interesting. I would say that on the space side, it's quite a different end of the spectrum because it is extremely expensive, will remain quite expensive to be a space actor for a good amount of time. And so one of the ways that we're thinking about trying to build in the pro-social aspects of systems was actually inspired by a speech, a Roosevelt speech from many, many decades ago in the United States around the freedoms from or freedom to. And what are the freedoms from in a space environment? And one, for example, might be freedom from living in a mill town, a corporate-owned entity that got you to the moon, and therefore you're not allowed to leave the moon until you finish your work, and it's a really extractive, exploitative process. And so to avoid some of that, there are interesting groups using, because we're so far away from that future, we're at least maybe 5 or 10 years away from that future, using the provocation of the blank slate of let's think about governance challenges now, and then think about, you know, organizations like Open Lunar, for example, how do you then incentivize the early commercial actors before they are given their first FAA, which is a regulatory agency in the United States, before they're given their first launch license to go to the moon? We've already baked in some of these principles into that next generation actors. And so some of that is through liability and punishment. Some of it is through pro incentives.
How much does it help that it's a blank slate? Because in some ways, there are probably fewer lawyers, at least, that work on space law. And I remember, you know, and Larry in the early days was working on internet law, and we created an internet law where there wasn't that much in that. I don't know whether there's any equivalence, relationship between internet law and space law, and whether we can, because there aren't as many regulations, whether we can hack together a framework that's more informed by Web3.
Yeah, I mean, one of the challenges is if it's just corporations framing this, there will at some time be a conflict between the business model and the exactly. rules they've framed. And if you, one of the most interesting things about the Facebook papers, Facebook files, is the number of times inside of Facebook that you had engineers trying to do the right thing, and the corporation from the top just saying, no, we're not gonna let you do this because it's against our stock price interest or whatever. And so the question is whether these founding principles can be complemented by like binding obligations, which typically requires government. But the challenge in the United States right now is we don't have a functioning government. So the idea that the government will help or enforce is hard to imagine, which I think makes the project you're talking about even more important, because if you make it feel constitutional to the process, then it'll be harder to resist it.
That's exactly what we're trying to do, is frame it as drafting a new constitution of actors, and to think about it as painted as a potential tragedy of the commons. Space really is a big new commons. And so if we have one side that defects, a corporation in the United States, they will suffer the defecting of a Chinese corporation who's also on the moon and should have kept the same norms but failed to. And so maybe a little bit of a prisoner's dilemma. We hope that we can get actors into being, maintaining some norms of behavior, but also a very optimistic view, which will be challenged as soon as business models are challenged.
There's an interesting thing that I've observed, which is when you do venture investing, you typically control the company through a shareholders agreement. So when you buy the shares of the company, you legally bind the entrepreneur to do this, to represent this, blah, blah, blah. But the minute it becomes a token offering, an ICO, it's no longer in the control of the entrepreneur. The entrepreneur cannot legally do anything. And it's all about the token economics. And what's interesting about investing in token projects is you have to analyze what's the technology, what are the economics, what are the incentive of all of the stakeholders. And what you do is you try to model, are the incentives of the stakeholders such that if I invest my money, I'm gonna make money? That's how an investor has to think. So it's no longer a bunch of lawyers copy pasting every kind of rule that you can think of. It actually becomes a business model analysis incentive process. And then in addition to that, putting in controls where as a customer, so the best investors, like we were hearing from Animoca Brands, the reason they're a good investor is they're often the customer as well. So they can see the entity, they have influence over the economy of the thing. And so what's interesting, I think, about Web3 is that we use law, we use technology, we use markets, and we use norms. And a lot of the values of these markets is also how does the community feel? Is it vibrant? So in a way, I think the sort of management of Web3 is really those four quadrants together, where traditional economy has been mainly sort of economics and law, and now we've got these other elements, and I think that, I don't know if you...
Yeah, I just wanted to generalize that and just continue asking a question here for all of you guys, which is, this is arguable, but if we were to say that, old school, Web 1 that we were all around for is read, and Web 2 is write, and Web 3 is own, then that concept of ownership, which you're alluding to just now with the tokens and so on and so forth, I'm curious how that intersects with everything that we've been talking about, like the how that intersects with trying to reinforce space law such that people don't end up in futuristic, company towns, or the business model aspect and so on and so forth. It seems so central, like we're all so excited about the possibility that there can be so much more ownership, it can be much more inclusive. You know, those of us who still have stars in our eyes about this stuff, which includes myself. And then we look at the diagrams like the one you showed, Joy, which was, the traditional corporate cap table is, it's the owners, it's the investors and the founders. But then a cap table for a tokenized company, it's astounding by traditional standards, right?
But
half of the tokens are for the users. That feels incredibly empowering.
Right. It's a hard problem to solve well. And Vitalik's book, I think, is really powerful as an example of struggling through that architectural design question for producing public goods in the context of, for example, cities. I mean, describing projects that are like designing ownership interests, which are, in the structure that I said, you have a public good as a byproduct of private goods, right? So they're structuring ownership interests with a mind towards how that will set incentives so that everybody behaves in a pro-social way, right? So it's not denying incentives, it's not removing incentives, it's using them through this infrastructure to produce these public goods for communities. So you can reimagine ownership inside of a city, not of mortgages on a house, but ownership so that people have an interest in producing a beautiful city or in supporting the development of public spaces in the city. And you can't imagine how to do it in the abstract. You've got to practically engage and see how the incentives are developing and tinker with it to produce the incentives you're trying to get. And once you get it right, you can imagine it scaling across many different communities very quickly because it's just click and now you've built the DAO infrastructure that facilitates it.
And just to click on that for a second, but Vitalik, I was reading that paragraph, that chapter in the book, is very careful to warn that. Because the thing about tokens is once you set it going, you can't change it because you no longer have control, right? And if you set it up in a way that unfairly benefits the early adopters, 40 years from now, it doesn't work. And I think that planning for the long term in these token economics is really, really hard because you can't change it. And we're sort of this early, and like with domain names, very early days, the people who squatted domain names made a lot of money. That's peanuts compared to what happens if you give key pieces of space ownership to private enterprises, because you can't take it away very easily once you give people ownership. So I think that's the flip side, is that it's sort of the Wild West, and there are a lot of pioneers out there trying to make a lot of money. And if we want fairness, I think we have to be careful, but we have to move forward. Sorry, did I cut
you off? When you asked the question about ownership, it made me think of this bombshell Wall Street Journal article that had come out within the last month, about a group of CEOs that had come together that were not CEOs of B Corps, mission-driven companies. They were CEOs of major, Fortune 50 companies in the United States, and they said that they are going to push back against being purely shareholder driven. So they no longer have this Milton Friedman-esque, our only responsibilities to our shareholders. And so maybe there's beginning to be a bit of a sea wave around a different notion of responsibility and ownership, even in non-token, old traditional corporate stakeholder models, where they're actually now expected to help their communities, like the companies in San Francisco that are inhabiting in this really difficult city environment, take climate change into account, take ESG and SDGs into account. So maybe that model is also shifting to have a sense of ownership and social, pro-social behavior within that.
I didn't read that article, but what's the structure that backs up that rhetoric?
This was a great question in the article, which is, can those CEOs sustain their next board meeting? I think that they're still working out the structure. The question is going to be, will their markets respond positively to that?
And the skepticism has always been that these commitments cannot be contracts. That would be antitrust violations. So they can never be enforceable on their own. And like when they're put into a corner, the businesses will always defect because the market forces them to defect. You know, it's a great story. There's a great book on salt, fat, sugar, which is about the processed food industry. Yeah. And executives in the processed food industry realizing they're basically selling poison to people. But that's how they make money, by selling poison to people. And then certain of these executives decide they want to sell sell healthy food to their customers. So they change their processed food to be healthy. And of course, the customers hate it, and they like flee to the other products. And then these executives are given golden parachutes and like kicked out of the company, and they go back to their old ways. Because they might have lofty ideas, but they're in a market, and their market will discipline them to behave according to the market. So what they need, what these companies need, is regulations that might help them do what they think is the right thing. Yeah. And it's hard to produce, especially in a...
Or knowledge that the consumers, yeah, right?
Exactly, I was just gonna go there. Because there is the opportunity now for a company's customers to collectively, essentially guide that company towards the kind of products that it wants to buy. And the way that it wants to buy it, the way those products should be priced, and there is a way for the empowerment of not only the customers, but also the citizens of a city, the employees of a company that...
And I think that when we democratize AI and smart contracts, you should be able to write a contract that says, only do things that I want to do long-term, but when I want the beer at 5 p.m., don't advertise it to me. I mean, because Facebook says it's giving you what you want, but it's not giving you what you want to want, right? And what you want to want to want. And what you should be able to do is say, I don't want to eat snacks at midnight. I don't want to have a beer at 5. I want to go to the gym in the morning. And you should be permitted to have all of the media around you drive you to what you said you wanted to do in the morning, and to lock that into code, and to say, I don't want salty snacks. You know, so, and I think that both the awareness to make those decisions and then to be able to lock those in, I think could be things that we could develop tools for. And it's the same with your money. You should be able to say, make a big red light whenever I'm trying to do something that's unhealthy for me, that, and here's my definition of healthy and unhealthy. And that should be a customer choice that they make in advance, not in the heat of the moment, right?
I think the companies of the future that will lead are the ones that actively, continuously engage their customers in designing, co-designing products that those customers want. And that this is gonna be, you know, just sort of inherently how products are brought to market. If you have customers who help design the product, they're gonna be leaning in to buying the product, to talking about the product. It's a whole, I think, new opportunity for companies to compete in a way that is not about extraction of value, but in fact, this idea of co-creation of value.
But I do think that you use the term leaning in, and I think there's a great project called Koso Nippon, where they do a type of deliberative polling in local areas in Japan, based on Jeremy Fishkin's stuff from Stanford, and it's similar to what Larry's saying. They randomly pick people, engage them in conversation, and then get them to make policy decisions. But once they've engaged, they see that they're smart, that they can have an impact, and they become engaged. And I think in Japan, I think there's a lot of disengagement that could be engaged once they realize how fun it is, how much reward it is. Because like I think most consumers in Japan, if you ask them, would you want to co-create a product with a company, they would say no. But once, and it's like open source and the DAOs, once you participate in it, you realize it's a thing, I think you can flip. Because these 10,000 people who have gone through this Koso Nippon Iraba Takagi, they are all engaged afterwards, but they weren't engaged before. So there's also this process of how do you bring people in. And I don't know, maybe you've been quiet maybe because of English, but I'm curious, you know, when you go to the temples and you are talking to sort of normal Japanese people, How are you seeing their engagement? And do you think that you have an idea of that these Japanese people who just want to sit back and watch TV, do you think they'll engage in DAOs and Web3?
Japanese
You've been discussing about the business model. I just wanted to point a few points. That I think that the business channel has been changed. In case of Temple's Town, we done the business only for Temple, but with DAO, everyone, anyone can get in. So that the company people can come, regular individual can come, municipal official can come, and lots of collaboration were born out of it. So that the craftsman of the temple really happy because so many different perspectives were given to them. So that up to now, craftsmen were just creating something so sophisticated for the temple, but now freedom was widened. Maybe they can think something interesting for the visitors, or maybe build a Buddha overseas to please overseas people, or something building with 3D. And so that through the collaboration, that craftsmen themselves got really stimulated. And I think the channel, B2B, B2C, the blurred, the boundary between the channels are blurred. The DAO is a metaverse, one huge channel.
I think what's really interesting about this point is it reinforces the idea that if you can empower a wider range of people in the process of creation and development, it's a more resilient and effective structure than the concentrated structure. I mean, I don't think we remark enough about how remarkable the collapse of Facebook is. I mean, you know, they have lost in the last year $800 billion in value. You know, they were a $1 trillion company a year ago. They're a $200 billion company today. $800 billion. Why? Because they have a corporate structure where one guy calls the shots. Nobody can overturn him. Nobody has the stockholder, has the shares of stocks to reverse him. And he is so fixated on this crazy, idiotic idea of like building a metaverse that Facebook or Meta will own, and the world will come to the Meta, and he will be able to leverage the, I mean, it's completely ridiculous, but nobody can tell him that. And the company gets blown up because he will take it all the way down. The captain will sink with the ship. But these structures that you're describing, or that you're building, or you're enabling through this kind of AI infrastructure will inherently be more resilient because they will not have this concentration of authoritarian power. And you know, this is a lesson we've known for hundreds of years. Authoritarian institutions fail eventually. A lot of people suffer until they fail, but they fail eventually. And we ought to be, I mean, these technologies are enabling us to build non-authoritarian, much more inclusive, much more diverse institutions that will, I think, beat those types of institutions.
I wonder if Naomi's example is a point to your the branding problem that Web3 and DAOs have, but if we think about it instead of as this crypto bros, kind of very othering sphere, it's actually a fantastic opportunity for people to re-engage in a civic sense.
Yes.
And as government became big and complicated and opaque to most of us, and we think, oh, it's somebody else's job to run the government, I just go about my daily life. DAOs are a fantastic way to get engaged again in a really fun, meaningful community way, and that could be a branding that especially gets the Gen Z activist culture really excited about the future of Web3.
Yeah.
And I think that getting back to movement, you know, I think that what was amazing about the, especially the initial space movement, and in the US it was very well designed where they had, you know, space stations all over the South and they involved the whole country and everybody was cheering for space. It was the moonshot included the whole country, right, in the United States. And that was a very successful movement, I think. And it's getting tainted a little bit because of all the rich people wanting to go to the Mars and stuff like that. But it still has this kind of let's save the world together. And it, I think if done well with the climate issue, because I think, you know, Digital Garage, we use the term Earthshot, where it's something that Laureen and other people have been working on. But the idea of looking back at Earth from space kind of is this activating energy. And I think the Gen Z community that or is, I think, activated in the right way. If we combine this with Web3, I think it's a much more inclusive branding than kind of this idea of, you know, just, you know, screw the central banks, we're gonna go get an island and be crypto bros. And I think that, but I think it's connected right now already a little bit. I don't know if you're, are you a crypto bro? I'm sorry for me.
Yo, man, I'm a crypto bro. No, not a crypto bro. But yeah, I mean, just if Web2 was all about scale, and then we want to create the one property that the whole world uses, one of the things that really excites us non-crypto bros about Web3 is like what you guys have been saying as far as copy, paste, tweak, or if you find a good pattern, a good model, you don't even need the tweaking. You just copy and paste it for your local community or your local use case. That's the kind of scaling that feels like it doesn't turn into Facebook.
Pretty exciting. City of Cincinnati is an exciting project because of the engagement already. It's the very early days, but the engagement of the people who are living the life. They are very interested in coming up with solutions for the economic challenges and being part of that, and for the first time realizing that their voice will be heard.
Sorry, when you say living the life?
Living the life, meaning they are on the streets, they're in poverty, they're in gang-ridden neighborhoods or in gangs, mm-hmm. and realizing that they can, in fact, for the first time, participate in creating, you know, new strategies, new programs for jobs, new ways of governing their own city, and that their voice will be just as important as the most senior elected official or, you know, the head of a community foundation, because they have a unique experience that is equally valuable, and they also now have agency.
And that works because the structure that you set up is designed to make that work.
Exactly.
Without that, it's just, okay, yeah, you're heard, and then we're just going to go do our own thing.
That's right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Very interesting. Well, it's almost like we set it up because the next panel we have Sputniko and People Pleaser, who I think represent a new vibe that's sort of post-crypto bro. It's based on crypto bro, but a new one. And then we even have the mayor of Shibuya, who I think is actually trying to do things in a sort of a city way. And so I think it's going to connect. But I don't know if there's 2 minutes left. I don't know if anybody has any closing ideas on how we connect this infrastructure to the next level. Were you shaking your head with, you have some ideas? Or, sorry, anybody?
There. Well, I would just echo what you just said. I think if we had 1,000 projects like the Temple DAO, people would begin to have an imagination of what this is that makes it seem very different from the crypto bro model and the Facebook model, and get them excited to be involved. And I mean, the examples you're building, if cities began to see there was a way to bring people in, they would replicate that. And it's just building these examples and putting them out there that I think is the essential step to making this successful.
So hopefully after you watch the next half of the day, you'll see some solutions to the branding problem. Thank you, everybody.
Great.
See you in the next.
Thanks.